So last time you already defined, we have the dislocation line, the tangent vector t that we just described and revised. And then we also have so-called Burgers vector b. And today we will talk specifically about how do we define this vector. But the Burgers vector b tells you what is the magnitude of the deformation, right? In the case of an edge dislocation, we mentioned there is one additional plane inside of the crystal that deforms the material, right? So there is this one additional plane that in a perfect crystal doesn't exist. It ends up in a certain region of the crystal. So this would be the dislocation line. So when I look at this, so how the dislocation propagates throughout the crystal, this is the dislocation line. But the strength of this deformation is called a Burgers vector. Right, so you can imagine that you, for example, have two extra planes, then the Burgers vector would simply tell you that the magnitude of that deformation is larger than the magnitude of the deformation when you have only one additional plane, right? So we will talk about specifically what the Burgers vector means, so what the magnitude of that Burgers vector means, and also the relationship between Burgers vector B and the Burgers vector T will distinguish between edge and screw dislocations. So how do we define a Burgers vector? So in the case of an edge dislocation, it's a slightly easier case. So we will go through this. And I will also illustrate you how this works in screw dislocations. But this would be a typical edge dislocation, right? There is an extra plane of atoms in otherwise perfect crystal. And the material or the atoms are displaced for their ideal positions. And for that reason, this is a defect, right? So the definition or the way how we will construct this is described on the next slide, but this is for your, you know, for your information, but I will lead you through the process, right? So whatever we are doing is described on the next slide that you will have in the annotated slides. So we have to define something that is called a Burgers circuit or a Burgers circle. So how we do this? So we start from an ideal crystal, right? So you take an ideal crystal that does not contain any dislocation. And you start from an arbitrary atom within the material. And then you form a right-hand circle. And you try to count how many steps do you need to make to form the first full circle, right? So for example, I have to go two steps up, two steps left, two steps down, two steps right, and I will go from the starting to the finish point. In other words, I can just take a circle, making two steps in each direction. Again, the choice, yes? You can do any, but the reason why I've chosen this particular one is because we have to make a circle that will surround in the part of the part of the crystal that contains the dislocation, we have to make the full circle around the dislocation. The choice of the steps and how many steps in each direction is irrelevant. The result will be the same, but the main point is that you first do the step and you count how many steps you make in each direction, and then you do the same thing in the non-perfect crystal that contains the dislocation, right? And you make the full circle surrounding the dislocation itself. Okay, so we will do the same thing, right? So I will start from a starting point here. And again, you can convince yourself, you can choose any type of a circle, the result will be the same when you compare the perfect crystal and this particular defect, right? So this will be my starting point, and I will go two steps up, two steps left, two steps down, and then I go one step to the right, and I end up in the starting point. But I made two steps to the right in the perfect crystal to finish at the finish point. So this vector here between point S, or the starting point, and the point F, or the finishing point, in the part of the crystal that contains the dislocations, is called a Burgers vector. So this will be the Burgers vector for this particular dislocation. So you can imagine, again, if there were two additional planes, the Burgers vector would be twice as long, okay? So again, the length of this vector gives you the magnitude of the deformation. Again, there are certain conventions that are introduced here. So first you have to choose arbitrarily the direction of the dislocation, and then you make the right-hand circle, right? If you assume that this is the dislocation line, then the circle that we are making is right hand, if you choose it this way, etc. So there are some conventions, but this is the main idea. And different textbooks might use different conventions, but the main idea is that once you choose what is the dislocation line, make this right hand circle and figure out what is the, yes.
So the direction is sort of arbitrary, but the magnitude is what really matters?
The magnitude does matter, and the and once you choose the convention, then it doesn't matter. But the dislocation that has one Burgers vector has slightly different properties than the dislocation that has the other one. But for a given crystal, when you choose the convention, and if you stick to it, then it doesn't matter, okay? As long as you apply the same rule, okay? So in other words, if you choose different direction of the dislocation line, the Burgers vector will have the opposite direction as well. Okay, so this is how we define a Burgers vector in an edge dislocation. And for a screw dislocation, the way is the same. So how you apply this rule is that you also make a circle, and you count the number of the steps, and you make the full circle, and then calculate what is the resulting Burgers vector. And this is just a three-dimensional crystal, together with the two-dimensional projection of the same crystal that shows the Burgers vector in this particular case. Very often, students have a little bit more difficulty to visualize screw dislocations in comparison to edge dislocations, but this is more like a twisting of the material. And I do have a model of a screw dislocation here, so you're more than welcome to check it out after the class. So, but it's basically twisting or a screw type of an event in a crystal. And the Burgers vector in this particular case is this tiny red vector here that is indicated. And again, it is parallel, so the Burgers vector is indicated here. The dislocation line will be in this direction. And again, in the screw dislocation, you can see that we will see that these two vectors are parallel to each other. Okay, so just one, you know, just to convince you and show you how to do this Burgers vector calculation in screw dislocations. So if this was a perfect crystal, if I started from this position, and if I made steps down, I'm counting the number of the steps. If I go to the right, if I go up, and then left again, if this was a perfect crystal, if there was not this twist that is introduced by the screw dislocation, points F and point S would coincide. However, in this particular case, F is somehow displaced from the point S, and the resulting vector, SF, will be the Burgers vector in this particular case. Okay, so for screw dislocations, you have to observe this, or you have to think about this in three dimensions. For edge dislocations, it's much easier to project this into two dimensions. Okay, so just to again illustrate you, because again, screw dislocations are very often more difficult to visualize. The name itself comes from the fact that these screw dislocations propagate to the surface of the material and produce these surface-like features, right? So what you see here are the images. On the right-hand side is the scanning tunneling microscopy of a dislocation in gallium nitride, and this is silicon carbide on the left-hand side. So when the screw dislocation propagates throughout the material, because of this twist-like nature, on the surface of the material you will see this features that have a screw-like shape, and this is where the name itself comes from. So here you can even see at the atomic scale what is really happening. So these are individual crystallographic planes that are stacked on the top of each other in this twist-like manner. Okay? So to summarize, what we learned so far is that the edge and the screw dislocations, we define them by the way how they behavior, how their dislocation line is formed depending on the applied stress to the material. And through this analysis, we also learned that there is unique relationship between two descriptors, Burgers vector and the dislocation line in these two cases. So in other words, for an edge dislocation, the Burgers vector will be perpendicular to the dislocation line. And from before, what we know is that the dislocation line is perpendicular to the applied stress. For the screw dislocations, the Burgers vector and the dislocation line are parallel to each other. And from what we know from before is the dislocation line is parallel to the applied stress. So these are two major types of dislocations. there are many, there are types of dislocations that have mixed character. What would you say it's a mixed dislocation? So here we have two extreme cases, right? These two vectors are either parallel to each other or they're perpendicular to each other. If you have any situation where these two vectors have any arbitrary angle, this would be called a mixed dislocation. So what that means is it has in part edge and it has in part screw character, okay? And again, why we talk about this is because we will see that the screw and edge dislocations can have very, very different properties in the materials, right? So mixed dislocations are the ones that have a character in between edge and screw. And the main point here is that dislocation Burgers vector, or the magnitude of the deformation, is preserved when the dislocation propagates throughout the material. But you can imagine that the dislocation line, as I showed you before, right? Dislocation line is not necessarily a straight line. It can change the direction, et cetera. And if that happens, and the Burgers vector is preserved, what that means is that you go from a situation when you have a screw dislocation, in this particular case, here at this part of the crystal, the dislocation line changes, the Burgers vector remains preserved, and when the dislocation line exits at this particular surface, it has an edge character. So here, at the beginning, the dislocation is a screw dislocation. At the end of this analysis, it's an edge. Everything in between is a mixed dislocation. So again, to summarize here, this is the Burgers vector, the dislocation line T. This is the Burgers vector, the magnitude and the direction is preserved. This would be the dislocation line T. Everything in between is a mixed dislocation. And typically, when people talk about mixed dislocations, they separate the edge and the screw part of this dislocation, and they treat them separately. Or they try to understand how this mixed dislocation behaves depending on whether it's more like an edge or more like a screw type of a defect. Okay, so why do we care about these numbers? Why do we care about the Burgers vector? Why do we care about the dislocation line, etc.? So we already mentioned that the dislocations are non-equilibrium defects. And the reason for that is that they store elastic energy, right? So if you deform the material, part of that elastic energy will be preserved in form of dislocations, or the energies that are stored by the dislocations themselves. And in fact, it can be up to 5% of the elastic energy that is being stored in the form of dislocations. And the reason you can see that these dislocations do indeed store some energy is from the fact that when you look around the dislocation core, everything above the dislocation core will be in compression. So the atoms will be closer together relatively to what would be their equilibrium position in a perfect crystal, and they're in tension beneath the dislocation. So there is some strain that is associated with the presence of this dislocation. And this elastic energy, there are certain properties and the constants that depend on the material, but in general, the elastic energy is proportional to the Burgers vector squared. So you can see that if you have, for example, a dislocation with two extra planes, the Burgers vector will be twice as large, and the stored elastic energy will be four times larger than if you have a Burgers vector where you introduce only one set of planes, right? So again, that already means that if you have a dislocation with a specific Burgers vector, it can separate into multiple dislocations, let's say two of them, B1 plus B2, where the vector is preserved, right? So from the vector perspective, B1 plus B2 is equal to B, but B squared, if it's larger than B1 squared plus B2 squared, in other words, if the elastic energy that is stored by the initial dislocation is larger than the elastic energy that is stored by two new dislocations, if this is true, then this dislocation is likely to separate into two, right? So what, again, that means is that you can form dislocations. They can also separate and make multiple types of defects within the material. And whether this will happen or not depends on the relative relationship between the Burgers vectors. Again, this tells you why the Burgers vector itself is a relative descriptor, or why do we care about this, right? We care about the direction, because it determines whether the dislocation is edge or screw. And the magnitude itself tells you whether this dislocation is, for example, stable, or how much elastic energy it stores in the material.